I just haven't won, but I guess there's one.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Reeser. In a moment, the Beaverton Police Honor Guard will post the colors. When the audience hears the command, present arms, those in uniform will perform a military salute. Those not in uniform will place their hands over their heart. Please rise for the posting of the colors.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, oh, the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the
Hello, I'm Fabiana.
And I'm Talik.
We are so honored to serve as the co-chairs of the Mayor's Youth Advisory Board.
MYEP serves as a bridge between local government and our city's youth.
It's our honor to introduce the Mayor of Beaverton, Lacey Beaty.
She recently completed her second year as mayor, and before that served for 6 years on the Beaverton City Council.
She was also a leader in public health, managing school-based health centers in 5 school districts and in 2 counties.
Mayor Beaty is a veteran and was a combat medic in the Iraq War.
As the youngest ever elected official and the first woman mayor in Beaverton's history, she is committed to making our community even more diverse, inclusive, and welcoming.
Mayor Beaty is married to Ian, and together they have a daughter named Ayla. And as you'll soon see, they have one more on the way.
I know she's pumped to share with you this year's State of the City Address.
So without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, Mayor Beaty.
Good evening. Thank you, Talik and Fabiana, and thank you for the Reser for hosting us tonight. Beaverton is so grateful to have you. And of course, I am 8.5 months pregnant, and she is ready to join us in any minute. So getting through tonight was going to be the marquee event before the new vice mayor joins us. And so you have to cut me a little bit of slack, because it is really hard to talk with a basketball in front of you. We are so happy to have you, and thanks for being here. How about this spot, right? The research is pretty cool. I want to take a moment before we begin to thank a few important people. Of course, my family, my mom, the matriarch of our family, is here in Beaverton that supports us. To my vice mayor, my wonderful daughter, Ayla, who wanted to make sure that I told you she knew all 26 letters of the alphabet, and could count to 240 by twos. So she's perfectly suited for this job. And of course, my husband of 18 years, Major Beaty, who spends his day in service to the Oregon Army National Guard and picks up the slack at home. Without them, I couldn't be the best daughter and wife and mother. And most importantly, it takes a really great family to be a really good mayor. So I appreciate them. We're also joined by quite a few elected officials. I want to thank State Senator Campos for joining us, State Representative Chachi, State Representative Graber, Metro Councilor Christine Lewis, Councilor Juan Carlos Gonzalez, Councilor Rosenthal, our mighty county chair, Chair Harrington, her colleagues, Commissioner Fai, and of course, my mayor colleagues that have joined me, the Hillsborough Mayor, Steve Calloway, North Plains Mayor Terry Lanahan, and Tigard Mayor Heidi Lube, our wonderful partners at THPRD, Barbie Miner, Alfredo Moreno, and Tia Ping. And of course, I couldn't do this work without our colleagues on City Council. Council President Hartmeyer Prigg, you probably saw wheeling in the back, Councilor Duggar, Councilor Husson, Councilor Kimmy, Councilor Teeter, and Councilor Kibnon, along with distinguished guests. Welcome to the Reser this evening. It's good to be together in person, to celebrate the state of our city. A year ago, I sat in the audience and recorded my state of the city, but I was alone. This is way better. And your presence marks more than the power of a live audience and live connection. It's the symbol of our living partnerships. If there's one thing that became clear to me in 2022, it's that government works. We can bring positive change to people, but we can't do it alone. Government success, community success, depends on strong partnerships. Our partnerships with community organizations and activists and small businesses and large corporations are vital to the kind of shared success we need. But here in Beaverton, we need a different kind of partnership as well. Cities like ours depend on cross-collaboration of all levels of government to tackle the complex issues we face. Across our region, no challenge is a bigger priority than housing and homelessness. We made tremendous progress this past year getting more people into Beaverton into housing, because housing is a fundamental human right. And there is no reason anyone in our community should go without safe, affordable housing year-round. But for some, traditional housing is still out of reach. As your mayor, I want you to hear loud and clear that in Beaverton, we are committed to compassionate action to help people living outside get immediate social services and move along a path towards permanent housing. For far too long, a person in Beaverton experiencing homelessness had nowhere to go for year-round emergency shelter. Not anymore. Being a good regional partner means we're also part of the solution, which is why I'm glad to say we are very close to completing Beaverton's first year-round shelter. And with that last little bit of funding we need, it could be open by this time next year. Beaverton Shelter at 217 and Beaverton Hillsdale Highway will serve 60 adults. It'll be operated in partnership with Washington County and contacted through community service providers. Thank you to Senator Wyden and Senator Merkley and Congresswoman Bonamici for their partnership that brought $3 million of federal funding home to Beaverton, making this project a reality. And thanks to Governor Kotek for including Beaverton in the executive order declaring a housing and homeless state of emergency in Oregon, which we hope will provide that final funding. And I know our staff is here, so no pressure. We need a little bit more money to complete it. But perhaps the most important partner in this project is the Beaverton community, who understands the value of shelter and has continually supported of its development. City staff are currently working to gather community feedback to develop a good neighbor agreement for residents surrounding the shelter. This is a perfect example of how our community works together to ensure that everyone's voice is heard, and we take community challenges head on. Beaverton remains a highly desirable place to live. When other parts of our region have seen people move out, we continue to see people move in. But our city isn't cheap. The average home price here is well over $500,000. And market forces of finite supply and popular demand will continue to drive up prices. Our answer in Beaverton is pretty simple. It's to build. Building new affordable housing and market rate housing is our best check to out of control housing prices. We broke ground on two new affordable housing projects in 2022, both in South Cooper Mountain. Affordable housing restores a sense of dignity and pride for individuals and their families. It also demonstrates that here in Beaverton, we can balance land use with housing needs and access to nature with access to new homes. In June, we began construction on the Wish Camper property that will house over 300 Beaverton residents, 164 units, including 80 senior one-bedroom apartments. This development will be adjacent to our regional trails and next to Mountainside High School. In November, we broke ground on another affordable housing project, this one also near Mountainside High School, with 75 units. These new communities are being developed in partnership with Metro, Washington County, our community partners, who will help us coordinate the outreach to ensure an equitable leasing process. These apartments will be available to people making 30 to 60% of the area median income. But what does that mean? That means a family four of Beaverton making $25,000 can still afford to live here. That's a pretty big deal. But we couldn't do this work without our strong partners. Tualatin Hills Park and Recreation District, thank you for taking the bold step to waive system development charges for these new housing units, which helps us reduce the cost of housing. Our community strategy takes a whole of community view. To continue to attract talent across the professional spectrum to live and work in Beaverton, we need more housing, period. I'm so encouraged by our productive community dialogue we have around our Cooper Mountain community plan. We plan to build roughly 5,000 new homes with an emphasis on inclusive neighborhoods, practical infrastructure, and preservation of our natural resources. Projects like these will focus on creating sustainable, functional housing in neighborhoods and are the metaphorical and literal backbone of our city. I look forward to our continued work on attainable housing with our partners in 2023. And as these partnerships and projects show, Beaverton is building for tomorrow. A tomorrow we know that will be increasingly more diverse. A tomorrow where we and our elders and our children will have different needs than we have today. This type of creativity for the future is rooted in our partnerships today. I've worked with state lawmakers to implement the missing middle housing law. It passed in 2019 to give Oregonians more housing choices and make it clear, to make it easier to develop more affordable housing. This legislation furthers our housing social safety nets through efforts like eviction prevention mediation grants, which will help people stay in their homes. And it will also ensure that we can build a wide range of homes for needs of people, so that way when your family grows, you can stay in the same neighborhood. Giving property owners more flexibility to build small units on their land not only preserves people's whole property rights, but also increases housing affordability. These projects are essential to making housing attainable for all, living our environmental priorities, and adding longevity to our neighborhoods. One last point on housing, and it's a cool one. In our region's crisis, a lot of effort has been placed on shelter needs and housing affordability, but we can never lose sight of the fact that just because someone is housed doesn't mean that they are safe or healthy, especially during extreme weather events. For many of us who grew up here, air conditioning may have been a luxury. Certainly an option, but not the standard. Unfortunately, the extreme heat waves our cities have endured in the recent summer have changed that. Air conditioning is now a public health necessity, which is why I worked with our state lawmakers to pass the Protect Tenants' Rights to Cooling and provide funding for affordable air conditioning units and heat pumps. This was a hugely important step to ensure low-income individuals can stay cool and safe as climate change continues to have these extreme weather events become more common. I'm proud to have worked with our state lawmakers to create a positive legislation for not only Beavertonians, but for all Oregonians. I'm extremely proud of the work and the progress we've made in housing in 2022, and I look forward to continuing to work with our partners and keep this momentum up for 2023. It's one thing to feel safe at home. It's another to feel safe when you step outside in the community. In Beaverton, we want everyone to feel that sense of safety and security wherever they go in our city. And nowhere is that feeling more important than in our schools. We are finishing a series of community conversations focused on reevaluating the role of school resource officers. And we're trying to determine the best way for students to ensure that our schools are a safe place to learn, play, and grow. Guiding our principals in this work are two long-term leaders in their field, both newly returned to Beaverton last year, Police Chief Stacy Jepson and Superintendent Gustavo Baderas. Thank you for answering the call to come back to Washington County. Thank you for stepping up to serve the people of Beaverton and diving into this important work. The attraction of Beaverton and the quality of life here would not nearly be as high without our strong partnerships with our community, our law enforcement, and our school district. Sadly, we cannot talk about public safety, and especially keeping our young people safe, without talking about the tragically high rates of gun violence in this country. As a veteran, a gun owner, and most importantly, a mother, this issue hits especially close to home. I'm proud that the state of Oregon ranks 11th in the country for strong gun control laws, but unfortunately, it isn't enough. Last year, I called for the implementation of several crucial gun safety measures, including banning high-capacity magazines and automatic weapons, establishing mandatory background checks for gun purchases, and requiring safe storage of firearms. The vast majority of gun owners are responsible, but we need tighter laws if we're serious about ending the horrific gun violence we see all too frequently in this country. But for most of us, daily safety is not related to gun safety. It's road safety. It's well-maintained sidewalks, accessible crosswalks. Keeping drivers and cyclists and pedestrians safe is a crucial part of Beaverton's overall public street safety plan. We're improving roads and traffic calming procedures to reduce speed, and we're increasing public input to shape the future of our traffic safety solutions. I'll talk more about those efforts in our related downtown Beaverton loop strategy in a moment. But first, I want to acknowledge two major innovations coming out of our municipal courts. They're doing their part to keep Beaverton streets safe. One addresses drunk driving and the other mental health. Our Be Sober DUI court targets individuals with a history of driving under the influence of drug or alcohol, and it offers intense treatment for up to 5 years to help people overcome addiction and avoid traditional prison sentences. Where other programs have failed, we continue to hear from graduates about how this program is the crucial difference maker to helping them stay sober. And the Behavioral Health Court follows a similar model, offering 12-month treatment recovery program for people struggling with mental illnesses. Just this last month, Judge Britton and her team received a note from a current participant. We'll call him James. James is getting his life back on track, and he couldn't be more proud. He sent a photo to the judge of his front door with the words underneath that said, "Finally having a door that locks." Simple things. The dignity of having a private space to call your own. It was the first time in 10 years of being homeless that James had a door that he could lock. In 2022, 30 individuals graduated from these two programs. That's 30 people who have the resources they need to remain sober, stable, and successful, and to stay out of the criminal justice system and out of our overpacked emergency rooms. These are the partnerships that make a safe, thriving community possible. Partnerships are also what help us define and improve the Beaverton we love. Think for a moment about the places you love. Picture them in your mind. It may be a park. It could be your favorite food cart. My family, we love Highland Forest Park. It's where you see us doing our Spartan training. I mean, you know, when I'm not 8.5 months pregnant. Maybe for you, it's the library. We love the library too. In fact, it's the highest circulating library in the state. Now take the people, yeah. But take away the people from the vision in your mind. Your favorite tacos aren't so hot with somebody not on the other side of the grill. The new pickleball court, not much itself without a partner across the net. We are hardwired for human connections. And that's why the concept of partnership is always at the heart of placemaking here in Beaverton, starting with our Reimagining Downtown Loop project. Dalib owns the Family Cafe on Broadway. His cafe is a prime example of a company that embraced change during the pandemic. It's a great spot. In fact, it's become so popular that over the last few years, the Family Cafe is expanding its outdoor seating space, thanks to a grant received as part of the Open Air Beaverton program. Thank you for being here tonight, Dalib. But you know what? To walk from the Family Cafe to the Reser, you gotta cross a state highway and maybe a freight rail line. And for many other central Beaverton spots, it's not uncommon to cross two state highways. These gigantic through roads are great for a lot of things, but not for fostering foot traffic and creating that pedestrian vibe that we need to get the most out of our city center and each other. For businesses like Dalib's to thrive, we need to continue to invest in the walkability of our city. And that's where the Beaverton Loop Project comes in. The Beaverton Loop Project has already received $2 million of federal funding to help us plan the loop in its entirety. And thanks to Congresswoman Bonamici, who gave us a $4 million community grant to demonstrate a part of that loop to put us in line for more future funding. Thank you, Congresswoman, for your leadership. So if you're counting, that's $6 million. It's a lot of money. Projects like the Loop go far beyond standard fare infrastructure. Thanks to our community input from volunteers like Dalib and comments from many of you in this room, we are reimagining our streetscapes. Wider, more attractive sidewalks and streets have the power to literally move people together. And I'm excited to see how the Loop will foster a stronger connection between Old Beaverton, Old Town, and Beaverton Central. For those of you that venture out of the core from time to time, we all do, and you travel to the east side of 217, you see those orange barricades by Kaiser on Western Avenue. This is a signature project of our West 5 strategy, and it is well underway. With expanded 5-foot-wide bike paths and 6-foot-wide sidewalks, we are building safety and access like never before on this critical north-south connector between Allen Boulevard and Beaverton Hillsdale Highway. I want to thank our friends at Tualatin Valley Water District for their work on this project. They helped us install a 4-foot-wide water pipe under the road, and that is critical for Beaverton and our industries. 4-foot-wide pipe is pretty big. I went out and checked it out. Our Fertile Valley is the envy of the world, and how we use and reuse water here is not just about pipes and industry. It's how we extend our spirit of conservation and our most natural resources. It's about today's homes and tomorrow's heritage farms and backyard growers. And I'm pleased to share that as of today, we have built 3.5 miles of purple pipe to reuse stormwater for irrigation that otherwise would have gone to waste. This work conserves the Tualatin River while providing much needed water to our fastest growing part of the city. All right, you've been seated for a while now. What do you think of the Reeser? More comfortable chairs, way more legroom. If you've been to, you know, maybe an art center in the city east of us, I think this one is pretty cool. Nope, yeah. It's hard to believe that the Reeser is barely 1 year old. Since it opened last year, we've already had 178 shows here, featuring some of the most talented and diverse performances in any major city. With the Reeser, we wanted to be intentional about the stage, that it was for everyone, a true community gathering place. But showcasing the talent of our BIPOC community up here on stage has not always brought the most diverse audience out there. That is until one of our Beaverton guys came home recently. Stephen Green grew up on 185th, attended Aloha High School, and went off to become a venture capitalist. But he never forgot his roots. In 2015, he founded Pitch Black, creating an annual Shark Tank-like event for Black entrepreneurs to pitch their ideas, gain funding and exposure, and buck the venture capital trend that too often awarded seed money to the same type of people. This year, for its largest ever event and the pitch competition's first time outside of Portland, Stephen brought Pitch Black home to Beaverton and held it here at the Reeser. And the results were the earliest ever sold out event, $90,000 sit home with Black founders and entrepreneurs aimed at community input. Congratulations to Black and Beaverton and Beaverton Black Parent Union for your honors. And thank you, Stephen, for bringing this marquee event here to the Reeser. He's out in the audience, so if you wonder how he did it, find him afterwards. You see, in Beaverton, when we talk about community development, we really do put the community part first. When people think about places they love, oftentimes the first thing that comes to your mind is your home, your school, or your place of work. And I want that feeling to be true for everyone in Beaverton, especially our youth. In November, we cut the ribbon on Home Plate's new drop-in center in downtown. Home Plate's incredible work helps Beaverton youth facing housing insecurities and difficulties. They provide tools for job search, education services, emotional support, and most importantly, just a safe place to relax. And I'm stoked to announce since last May, they helped 75 young people move into stable housing. Speaking of places that support our youth, in 2022 was an incredible year for our libraries. This year, the Library on Wheels delivered books and hosted story times in 2 new preschools, established a grab-and-go collection at the Beaverton Transit Center so you could grab a book before you get on the MAX, and they opened 2 new community bookshelves in partnership with THPRD to have books in our parks. The library did this while establishing a new makerspace that served over 4,000 Beavertonians. The design and make space let visitors use state-of-the-art equipment like Cricut machines, engineering tools, modern sewing machines, and even a 3D printer to create to your heart's content completely free of charge. And I know some of you are wondering why all these cool gadgets are only for kids. Good news, it's not. We have no age limit on our makerspace, so go out there and check it out. So what will we build together in 2023 and beyond? Just remember what we did throughout the pandemic. We made partnerships across healthcare sectors with the State National Guard, federal funders, and volunteered to do the most rapid vaccine rollout most of us have ever seen in our lifetime. We can do big things. Government can do big things, but only when we do it together in partnership. This year, we're building new partnerships with the federal government. Along with the U.S. Conference of Mayors, I've been clear that our national epidemics of fentanyl and drug use and mental health issues and homelessness require a national crisis response. All of our cities are unique, but our problems really aren't. They cut across borders and they're born out of the ongoing national issues. In 2023, we will build stronger partnerships at the federal level to keep tackling these issues head on. In addition to our incredibly valuable external partners, our partners within local government are just as vital to help our city operate smoothly and to make progress the community demands and deserves. I have to give a huge thank you to all of our city staff. I'm honored to be working with a new city council this year in a new form of government. Beaverton has grown up. We're the sixth largest city. And a couple of years ago, our voters said they wanted to professionalize our city management. And we have done just that. We have the political leadership in place to set the vision for our inclusive city. And that is built on community input and democratic values. And now we have the management in place to carry that vision forward and live out our values in our day-to-day work. City Manager Jenny Hariyama, thank you for bringing your expertise, your professionalism, and your boundless energy. You are the partner we need in City Hall to help us write the next chapter of Beaverton's story. The City Council met recently to set our goals and priorities for the coming year, which many of them we've discussed today around housing and safety, but we also decided it was the time to dig into the nuts and bolts that make our government work for you. Alongside good government, we need a strong economy, and we have one. If there was anything I learned in the past few years that is here in Beaverton, we are resilient, and that applies to our economy as well. The councilors and I want 2023 to be not just the year of financial recovery, but prosperity. Our job is to ensure that you receive clear, consistent communication regarding our economic recovery. We're doing this so everyone in our city is fully aware of our economic progress, and because we want everyone to participate by attracting new employers, encouraging investment, and in shared prosperity. We know that in the past, economic opportunities in Oregon have not extended to everyone, especially our communities of color. We will not accept that going forward. That is why we committed to conducting an equity analysis that helps us identify gaps in our current system and strategies to address biases and disparities. Following this analysis, we will create a financial recovery engagement and implementation plan that centers equity as we rebuild. Friends, we're going deep this year. The mechanics of running a 100,000 person city are changing. And what it shows the world about Beaverton is we are stepping up our game. Same old is over. Look around. This place is the new icon of the West Side. In an era where suburban cities are literally wondering where their city center is, we have a core we have been developing for decades. We have the highest walkability score of any suburban city in the state, and we are just getting started. We have so much to build on. I can't wait to see what our partnerships bring us in the year ahead. Thank you for being here in the region. Thank you for being here with each other. And thank you for being the best partners for all of Beaverton. We're going to end tonight with an awesome video. So sit back, relax, and enjoy the show. Thank you.
Hey, community. Thanks for joining me today at City Hall. I think many of us realized in this last election that we have a lot of new representation from our city council all the way to the governor. And I wanted to make sure that as the mayor, they saw our community through our city's eyes. So me and the team, we've developed a 3-hour walking tour of downtown Beaverton and the Loop. And we took 11 different elected officials on this tour, including now Governor Tina Kotek. I'm excited to take you on that tour today. So join me and our city councilors on Beaverton's next great adventure. Hello, we're here at the Patricia Research Center for the Arts, the northernmost point of our loop. I'm here with Councillor Allison Tibnon to talk about a couple things. We're going to talk about the Patricia Research Center for the Arts and about water and one of my favorite projects this year, the Purple Pipe. So when you drive up to this building, you notice a couple things. You notice some really big art installations on the outside of this building. Can you tell me a little bit about the 1% for the Arts and how we fund it?
Yeah, so for capital projects, 1% of the budget is set aside for public art. And in this case, that resulted in 4 really beautiful art installations, 3 on the outside of the building, 1 on the inside, and all of which you can see as you're approaching the research. And the fun part of it is that no matter what type of mode of travel you have or what road you take to get here, you're going to be greeted by art on your way in. We have this project called the Purple Pipe Project. People have probably heard this or read about it in your city newsletter. Can you talk a little bit about what the Purple Pipe is and how important it is to our community?
Only 1% of the water that we treat is actually used for drinking water. And at a time that we need to be thinking about our environment and how we utilize water and how we utilize our natural resources, the Purple Pipe was just an amazing opportunity to do some of those things at the same time. When we got to plan South Cooper Mountain, the first time we really got to plan a community in decades because of the urban growth boundary, the city council thought there has to be a better way. Can we reuse stormwater? Can we not use treated drinking water to do things like irrigation? And so sometimes development gives us wonderful opportunities to stop and think about how to do something old a new way. So I'm pretty excited about Purple Pipe. Thanks for joining me today. I know who would have thought that water and art were so interconnected, and the way that you talk about these topics is just awesome, and I'm so glad to have you on the team.
Oh yeah, thanks. I'm very happy to do another State of the City. It's going to be a great year.
Councillor Kimby, welcome to your first State of the City address. No pressure, but say hello to our friends.
안녕하세요. My name is Edward Kimby. I'm the new councillor who just sworn in about 7 months ago.
He has all the answers to everything we need. Councillor Kimby, we're standing in the Arts and Innovation District here around City Hall. BURA is the Beaverton Urban Redevelopment Agency. It's the agency that we put together after voters made a charter change to allow us to do this. And I think what's important for people to know about BURA is that all of our special districts came alongside of us and said this was important. But I kind of want to know from your perspective, you're a long-term business owner that owns a business here in the district as well. Why is this important to the work we're doing as city council?
The importance of arts is really dear to me because I play guitar, I sing, and I don't know if you know, but I sometimes write too. So I always crave for where to go. I didn't have to take the trip out to Portland or any other city, and I believe Beaverton really needed that. And so this place is becoming a hub for art and innovation. Just last year, we partnered up with the Oregon Startup Center and able to fund 5 new innovative businesses that hopefully they can thrive and contribute back to the city of Beaverton. In regards to nonprofits, I think we are the only ones in Oregon State or maybe entire United States that we got a fund to start nonprofit incubator that we have noticed during pandemic that there's community organizations and nonprofits were suffering because they couldn't get funds, they couldn't run the programs, and also they lacked the skills to actually run successful nonprofits. So we will partner up with Oregon Startup Center and try to use the knowledge that we have gained for last decade and help them to be more established and be successful, and they can orient themselves to serve the community, you know, more of a social services.
What I think is really interesting about a lot of the programs that you're talking about is that we've been able to work with partners to bring in federal money and state funding to accelerate our belief and dream of the downtown core here.
So this place, the Beaverton Central, it's where you can have arts, innovation, and just gathering place for everybody.
Councillor Kimmy, thank you for joining me today as part of our Loop Tour. I'm excited about what's to come for Beaverton.
Thank you very much.
All right, community, I'm here with Council President Hartmeyer Prigg on another stop along the Loop. I wonder how many people would know where we are based on the backdrop. We're on Broadway, where all these amazing restaurants and barbershops and small businesses exist. This is a street that a lot of people don't get to because it's sandwiched between Canyon and Farmington, and a little hard to get to, but it represents some of our most diverse restaurants in the city are located right here. When I'm walking over our dozen elected officials through the Loop route, I often talk about how important our community as a whole is. Why is the Loop so important to us right now?
Yeah, thanks, Mayor. The Loop is so important right now to create a truly walkable and safe district for our community. It connects the Reser and the Beaverton Central MAX station with Old Town, but because Farmington and Cannon are in between, people think they're really far away. So we really want to focus on creating a complete street for our community that is truly multimodal, so people can walk, roll, drive, take transit. But Mayor, it sounds expensive. How are we going to pay for it?
It's years and decades in the making, and it really tells the story of every level of government working together. So the city made the investment in this community originally, and just a couple weeks ago announced that we had a raise planning grant from the federal government. It was a $2 million grant that's going to allow us to plan the Loop in its entirety. Only three communities in Oregon were awarded that grant. It's kind of like winning the lottery. And we went to our Congresswoman, Congresswoman Bonamici, and told her about the project. She had congressional directed funding come to the city in total of $4 million to do a demonstration project.
I think it's such a great example of partnership to see how the city, how Bura, how our own local economy is really invested in this district. And I think it'll help make the Loop a success because the community has embraced this area.
Well, I think we already know from some of our other stops how awesome Beaverton is. We've opened a lot of restaurants. We're focusing on pedestrians and their experience and walkability. I'm just excited to serve on this council at this time. Thanks for joining us on this stop. I'm here with Councillor Duggar at Home Plate Youth Services. We have a couple topics to talk about, you and I, Councillor Duggar. I think one of them is top of mind for a lot of our community members is, how are we planning for housing for the future?
We've undertaken something called the Beaverton Housing Project, and that is going to allow us to use data as well as conversations with neighbors to figure out what is the best strategy, what are the different needs. Not every household has the same need. The goal of the Housing Beaverton Project will be to take all of this information and allow us to enact policies that actually get housing built to meet these needs over the next couple of years.
One of the things the council talks a lot about is home ownership and that upward mobility. What is the city doing to help people get into homes that they can own?
Yeah, so in the last few years, we've actually helped just under 40 Beaverton families buy their first new home through a couple different programs. One we call Welcome Home Beaverton, which is a down payment assistance program. We also have a really cool model with Proud Ground, which uses land trusts. And I think the key is to create generational wealth in families. And these tools, these are a couple tools that we have that we're doing. And that's our commitment is to help these families get started.
And when the voters passed the Metro Affordable Housing Bond, the city thought with our allocated resources, we were going to be able to do four projects. With our partnership with Washington County, we're actually going to be able to do five. And I want to say dignity is the focus of a lot of those efforts. Councillor Duggar, we get a lot of community feedback about homelessness, whether it's coming to us either on social media or through email channels. What is the city doing to help address this humanitarian crisis unfolding now?
Homelessness is one of our top priorities here. It is something we hear consistently, as you mentioned, from the community. The city's done a lot of work in this area. We know there's a lot more to be done, but so far we've created a winter shelter that operates from November to May to provide a safe place to rest. We have partnered with a couple different organizations to do street outreach, to do a safe parking program, which is really an incredible resource for a city of our size to be able to provide. Also, we're at Home Plate Youth Services, the day youth center for a large homeless youth population here in Beaverton. So we're trying to do innovative things and really focus on those partnerships that it will enable us to do so much more.
Councillor Duggar, we've talked a lot today about the different avenues in which we're addressing homelessness in our community, because we talked a lot about it being a complex problem. How does the shelter fit into our overall homeless strategy?
I think the first thing to recognize is that it will create a safe place to sleep. But that's not it. You know, that alone is not enough. We have to wrap around services, around health, housing, employment, right? Helping people treat the root cause that got them to the shelter. And I think that's critical. We talked earlier about our partnerships. The county is going to help us run that through SHS or a number of potentially nonprofits. It's an opportunity for us to actually treat some of the root causes that bring people to the shelter in the first place.
It took every level of government working together to create this shelter. It was the city council being disciplined and finding a place for it. It was us putting our own money in, the county and the Metro SHS grant that's gonna fund it. And recently we got a federal directed spending to help us work with tenant improvement programs. And so I just want the community to know it took all of us working together to bring that facility here to Beaverton. I know I gave you the very easy topics to talk about, so just, you know, no pressure, home run, but thank you for joining me today.
Thank you, Mayor. Always a pleasure to be with you and with you all, too. Thank you.
All right, community, we're in one of our favorite stops, the end of our tour, and I'm here today with our city manager. So you and I and our staff have put a lot of emphasis on downtown and revitalization, but I think everyone always wants to know, what exactly is the city doing to help revitalize our core?
So we've been really intentional about the investments that we've made in downtown, and we started with the most important person, our community. We started with our community vision and really wanting to understand what that North Star was. And it was that we wanted a vibrant downtown. The other is that we've built a grant program to support our businesses in perpetuity because we want them to thrive. And our building improvement grant is really a great example. Right here is Knock One, and they've been a recipient of up to $75,000 worth of grants to improve their building. We also provide art grants to kind of create that synergy in downtown, from signature events to all of the street murals that you've seen here. And it's just really a testament to this community that has put us kind of right dead in center of where we want to be. We also want to become a destination. And that's one of the reasons why we're continuing to infuse resources and funding into the downtown area.
We are very aware that when places become a desirable place to live, that sometimes community members get displaced. Council really wanted to get ahead of this problem that is coming, so we invested in a downtown equity study. And most importantly, when it was passed by council and Bureau that we've been talking a lot about today, we have some plans in place and we're getting ready to execute on those. All right, here we are in the heart of the Loop, the thing we've been talking about all day. How is the Loop going to impact our local businesses?
We all know that in order to have a vibrant downtown, you need that pedestrian foot traffic running around here so that we can support local commerce. And so it does just that. But one of the most important things that we're already starting to take into account is how this project can be disruptive to our merchants. We're going to make sure that we have all the input from businesses so that they're informed. We understand that the fabric of this community is made up of our businesses, but they're also the most vulnerable. That's why we're taking this effort to make sure that you know how much we care. If you're interested in finding out more about the Loop, check out beavertonoregon.gov for more information.
Thank you so much for joining me on our tour of downtown Beaverton today. I've said it once, I'll say it again. Beaverton is the place to be.